Are you all awake? Is everyone's memory still intact? Can someone remind me what the most important question in ornithology to me is? How do you tell a bird from a potato? So we shall continue with this course. Of course, now if Suhail says, what did you all learn from this course, and you say you learned how to tell a bird from a potato, he might be a little upset. But let's use birds and potatoes again to figure out. Let me just see how this works. Okay, I should use PDFs in full screen mode more often. So, when I said, how do you tell a bird from a potato, what did most of you say?
Birds can fly.
Birds can fly, birds can, yeah. But if you had to tell a bird from a potato from just photographs, what would you do?
Shape,
size,
color.
What else? What did Ashwin just tell you about?
Feathers.
Yeah, potatoes are feathers and birds don't, right? Wait, what? You're telling me birds are feathers and potatoes don't? Okay, and all of that comes down to what we call anatomy, right? So what is, if I were to ask one of you, some brave soul, get up and give us a little entertainment to wake us all up. Can you tell me the anatomy of a potato?
It has eyes.
A potato has eyes. Come on, who's that? Come on. Good. Tell us some more. If I had to say anatomically describe a potato, how would you do it? Has eyes, tastes good?
Has skin,
but birds have skin too. So that's not a helpful character, remember? Classification? If we said has skins and a potato has a skin and a bird has a skin, we're in trouble.
It has organs and organ system, but a potato doesn't.
But you can't tell that from a photo now, can you? So if I had to say from a photo, give me an anatomy of a potato. You can't say it's lumpy all over, so are birds. Umesh will tell you all about lumpy birds in a little while. That's the point. Right, Umesh? That's what community ecology is supposed to be, no? Lumpy birds, yeah. So, okay, potatoes are kind of lumpy. Potatoes are very obviously a plant. Why would potatoes be very obviously a plant? Structurally. Anatomy operates at different scales. So if I were to show you a photo of a potato and then a photo of a potato under a microscope, if I take a cross section of it, you'll see very different things. If I were to show you, let's not talk about cross sections of birds just yet. But if you were to now anatomically describe a bird, what would you do? Let's just say you didn't have access to all the modern tools that everyone has. Okay, let's time travel to 1860 whatever. And now say someone says, I ask you or you to describe this new bird. What would you do? What would you need first? You wouldn't have enough money to go to fancy places of the world to describe all the bird's features. So what would you get?
A specimen.
So someone shot a bird and sent it to you. Okay? Let's be blunt about what that is. And then what would you do?
Dissect it.
Okay, and you can dissect birds in pretty fancy ways. Now, how many of you are very good at dissection? Wow, non-zero, I'm impressed. Okay, I am absolutely awful at dissection, my hands shake. So if I were some big, bold 19th century ornithologist and I wanted to describe the skeletal anatomy of a bird and I tried to dissect it, I would end up with white powder where there once were bones. Okay? I once tried to dissect a hen head and I took the brain out of this and I described it in 7 pieces, so I had to put it together like a jigsaw puzzle. That's not what a systematist or an avian biologist should be doing. Okay? Fortunately, I don't live in the 1860s, so I can still do things without the help of that. But there is a way to look at a bird's skeleton without actually having to do that, and that's to get a bunch of beetles to eat all the flesh off of it and leave the bones behind. And then even somebody as clumsy as I can look at the skeletons and tell you what's going on. These beetles are called domestids. Okay, they're carrion eating beetles. And every museum in the world, pretty much now, has a colony of domestids in there, and they just drop the dead birds in there, and you know. So the Field Museum in Chicago, for instance, gets road kills all the time, or window strikes, right? Birds have hit windows. Now, you don't want to waste that. It's a valuable source of anatomical information. So what you do is you take these birds, prepare them, put them in with the domestids, let them clean out the skeleton, and then you can add it to your collection. And you don't have to add it to your collection in a way that is in any way damaging to the bird's population, except that they're hitting windows. So that's what's going on here. And then you have these little bone boxes full of bones, and you learn to recognize them and tell what a bird is. Okay? before we go any further about that, let's talk a little bit about bird bones. How many of you know anything about bird bones? They're pneumatic bones, okay? What does a pneumatic bone mean? Does it mean they sneeze? I don't know. They have air spaces. See, wait, you guys don't even need me to tell you all this stuff. This is what I call teach yourself. Let's all teach ourselves what a bird bone is. Why does a bird bone have air spaces, do you think? That's right. If you have something of the same size, okay, what governs its mass? Its density. If you have something that's dense, it's going to be really heavy. And birds don't... Being heavy is not a good idea for a bird because it needs to get off the ground. Right? Most birds. I'll get to a little modification of that in a minute. Now, when a bird needs to get off the ground, if it's too heavy, what's going to happen? In slow motion, Attenborough style, the bird will take to the skies and then fall flat on its face. This is what will happen if you or I think we can fly and try to flap our arms and run off the stage, correct? Birds lighten their bones by decreasing their density. So bird bones are brittle, actually. They're quite delicate and spongy because for the same size, they have a much lower mass. Make sense to everyone? You know what else developed this? You know how one of the other reasons we know this is a very useful tool in a flying animal? How many of you know what a pterosaur is?
No, pterodactyls.
Yeah, pterodactyls. If I said pterodactyls, you know. Jurassic World. Yeah, everyone's seen Jurassic World. They're those guys that fly. They had pneumatized bones too, so there is absolutely no way they could pick an adult human woman off the ground. Okay, let's just clear that out of the way. Because even the largest pterosaurs didn't weigh all that much. You could probably play cricket with them even if they were bigger than you were. Okay? Lightness is the key to getting off the ground. But not all birds get off the ground, right? What would happen to a pneumatized bone if you were, say, an ostrich that was trying to run around on the ground? Blow away the first wind, gust of wind? Well, perhaps not that much. But yeah, buckle under its own weight. If you have to run really hard and your legs are striking a hard surface repeatedly, brittle bones lead to stress fractures, right? Any one of us that has a calcium deficiency, we're often told, particularly if you're as heavy as I am, that you're at risk of stress fractures here because that's where most of the load acts, all right? And an ostrich with stress fractures is not going to last very long, is it? Right, particularly if a lion or something shows up. So flightlessness often correlates with an increased density of bone. You add more material to this bone because when you're on the ground, your constraint is strength, supporting your own weight against shocks, right? The trade-off between these two is something you'll find across a bird skeleton. Everywhere you look, you'll find a trade-off between staying strong and staying light, okay? You're always trying to be in that nice little sweet spot where you can get off the ground without falling on your face, but when you get back down on the ground, you're not going to break your bones. Make sense to everyone? Anyone have any questions? Cool birds they'd like to ask me about? No? Well, let's go on some cool birds ourselves then. Okay? So I want you to keep that in your mind when looking at the entire skeleton of a bird. The skeleton of a bird is a weird thing. Let's just get that out of the way too. Okay? A lot of things happened when a reptilian ancestor led to a bird. The most common thing that happened was that a lot of bones fused. Okay? These bones fusing are thought to be adaptive. So let's think from the point of view of what we call an adaptationist. Okay? It's not always the right way to think. But for now, let's think like an adaptationist. Who knows what an adaptationist is?
Changing the characters for the survival.
Yeah, that's adaptation. What is an adaptationist? That would be us. And let's get close enough. Someone who seeks to explain structures by what their adaptive value might be. What is adaptive value? That's what you said. Changing a character to, let's just say, improve survival under certain circumstances. Okay, let's keep it simple. Now, if we were to say what is the adaptive value of a lot of bones fusing, the most common trend seems to be you fuse bones in a lot of places so that they become one large bone and they can hold very, very large muscles. Why would a bird need very large muscles? Because again, it's got to get off the ground. Because all the light bones in the world aren't going to get you off the ground if you don't have the power to do that. You will still fall flat on your face. Right? So you need to be light, but you need to be powerful. But you also need to have strength. Okay? So a bird in itself, when you look at it, even a pigeon, I'm sure many people hate pigeons. I certainly do. Yeah? Some people are looking at me very aghast. Clearly a lot of people like pigeons here. But even the most common bird you see around you is actually a complex engineered animal. It's a complex phenomenon of engineering. And studying the anatomy of birds and how they do their thing, so to speak, can teach us a lot that we can apply when we're building stuff ourselves. They're very common, very simple common sense principles that apply to most of the bird world. Let's examine some of that, okay? Let's talk about bone fusion in the bird cranium. How many of you have seen skulls, generally? Lots of you have seen skulls, right? Now you will know that a bird skull looks very, very different from almost any other skull there is. Alright? That's because of several features. I'm sure all of you can point them out. Anyone want to try?
There is just large eye socket.
Large eye socket. Okay, let's go with that first. What did you say? Something about sutures?
Sutures.
What about sutures?
Fused skull.
The skulls are fused, skull bones are fused, so there are far fewer sutures. Yes? Someone said something else?
The beak.
A beak. Okay, so let's talk about those three features of a bird's cranial skeleton. Shall we? Now, what do fused skull bones enable? If you were going to think that fused skull bones are an adaptation. Shock resistance. Okay. Fused skull bones are better at shock resistance. Yes. Fused skull bones also make the whole skull lighter. Yeah. So again, you want to be strong, but you want to be light. Okay. Let's go near the second thing someone said. Large eye sockets. Or the orbit, okay? That's that big hole in the skull where the eyes sit. The orbits of a bird are very large compared to most other vertebrate skulls. Okay? What do you think that might, what function do you think that might serve?
Movement of eyeballs.
Birds don't actually, believe it or not, don't move their eyeballs all that much compared to some other animals. Birds usually look around by turning their heads. Or doing this. Anyone seen a bird do that?
Yes.
You've got eyes with big sideward facing visual fields and you want to look up, you've got to do this. It's not like the bird is thinking, aha, it's looking up. Okay? Now, what might large eyes help you do? Good job. Large eyes see better. See, it's all common sense. Large eyes help you see better. And if you're a bird that flies really fast, having well-resolved vision, if I'm going to be technical about it, is good. Because once you get off the ground without falling flat on your face, you don't want to bump into something and fall flat on your face, right? So the visual systems of birds, much like the visual systems of flying insects, are very good at resolving objects really quickly. If I were to release a parakeet from this end of the room, how fast do you think it would get to the other end of the room? Faster than you can run, okay? Now, if you ran as fast as you can from this end to the other end of the room, and everyone in your way threw things in your path, what do you think would happen? A big mess, right? Obstacle courses need a lot of practice. A bird's daily life is an obstacle course. And good vision helps it navigate that obstacle course. Not all birds have necessarily good vision. We'll get to that at some other point, I'm sure. And finally, let's talk about the beak. Okay? What is a beak?
Fusion of teeth.
Huh?
Modified jaw.
A modified jaw. Is it that modified? What is the modification of a jaw? Do I have a modified jaw?
No.
That enables me to yap on like this? No. So what's so different about a beak?
Beaks are fused together.
Covering of what?
Keratin.
Beaks or bills, let's be a little more technical and call them bills, are bony extensions that are modifications of the jaw bones covered with keratin. And this keratinous covering here is called a rhamphotheca. Okay, anyone want me to write that on the board for you? Not bad, let's go. Chalk is always fun. Rhamphotheca. What that means is that a bird bill is a composite of two materials, okay, just like fiberglass. And a composite of two materials gives you great resistance to fracturing. What might a bill do that it needs to resist fracturing? This is a parrot skull, in case you couldn't tell. Cracking seeds, yeah. When we eat hard food, our jaws are resisting fracturing at all points of time too, right? And covering bone with a sheath is great for fracture resistance, all right? It gives birds great strength, great capacity for bite force. So, the bird's bill has an upper jaw, a maxilla, a lower jaw, a mandible, okay? Let's get all that terminology out of the way. It has a rhamphotheca that covers it. And it has a series of bones that connect to it, okay? There are these bones right here. There is a bone that connects the skull to the mandible. Okay, there is something called a quadrate. Okay? Think of a quadrate as a little lever that does this. Okay? What's going to happen to this entire bone if the quadrate does this? Flips open. So if a muscle pushes the quadrate, I think there's a diagram of it in this book. So you've got no muscles here, but let's imagine there is a muscle that pushes the quadrate forward. It's just going to go whoop and out opens the lower jaw. Okay? And what happens when you open your jaw? You eat. If you eat, you survive. Hooray. And now that's about as much as you need to know about a bill. Okay? So that's how bills open and bills close. This is cranial kinesis. Okay, any zoology students out here, you probably heard the term cranial kinesis. Everyone probably fell asleep when their professor said it. I know I did. Yeah? Birds also have tongues. Tongues are supported by bones. Okay, these bones are called the hyoid apparatus. And the hyoid apparatus is different between, it's a very useful classification tool. We would ask Gaddo if he was still alive, he would probably tell us all about it. But his writings exist nonetheless. The hyoid supports different kinds of tongues depending on what birds need to do. Right? A woodpecker has this elongated tongue that it flips in and out that wraps around its skull. Parrots have these short sort of thick tongues that help manipulating seeds. If anyone has not watched a parrot eat, I thoroughly recommend it. It's a lot of fun. Okay? Any other bird tongues you can think of?
Sunbirds.
What's about sunbirds?
Long and thin.
Long and thin and?
Tubular.
Brush tipped. Why are they brush tipped? Because they act like a wick. They sponge up nectar, okay, because they have the capability of capillary action, okay? There are other animal tongues that can do that, like a bat. But a bat doesn't have a hyoid bone that necessarily supports its tongue the same way. So this is just a fun fact. Bats actually flush blood into their tongues to send it out. Nectar bats do that. All right? Once we move past the cranial skeleton, we've got the axial and appendicular skeletons, okay? What is the axial skeleton? Along the axis, the vertebral column. That too, in that case, you see a bunch of fusions of bones. The sacrum, okay, and the pygostyle, the tail bones of the birds, consist of a number of fused bones. Why are they fused? Because that gives them a greater surface area to attach large muscles onto. And when you have large muscles, you are capable of more power, not just flying. You could have large muscles attaching to the pygostyle that connect to your legs. One bird where that might be helpful is an ostrich, okay? Anything that is cursorial has a bunch of large muscles that attach to these places. And I think there's someone dissected a parrot a few pages down so we can see some of these muscles in a diagram. Don't worry, it's not gory. All right? Further to that, the axial skeleton has bones that connect to it, okay? For us, we've got the rib cage that protrudes and connects to the vertebral column at one end and the what at the other end? The sternum. And the bird's sternum is vastly enlarged, okay? You can see that here. This whole thing is the sternum of a bird. It's much larger than our own sternum. And it has, in addition to that, a little extension. So imagine this is the sternum. There is this big ridge that protrudes outwards. It's called a carina or a keel, okay? Like the keel of a ship. It provides a greater surface area for these large, large pectoral muscles to attach. And those help power the wing beam, okay? Particularly in pigeons, this is really fun to see. I think this is a pigeon, in fact. No, I don't know. But again, if you were to lose the powers of flight, you lose this skill. So people who find a fossil bird typically can tell with some confidence if it was flightless, if that keel is missing and if the breastbone is reduced, because those muscles also reduce. Because it's expensive, right, to have big powerful muscles if you're not using them. So they atrophy over evolutionary time, and in flightless species they become small, shrunken and reduced, and the birds don't need to do that anymore. Do the bones, do other bones reduce? What other bones do you think might reduce if a bird became flightless? Of course, the wing bones, right? Because they shrink backwards too. And what is a wing? It is a forelimb. It is a modified forelimb, right? A modified forelimb to do what?
Flap.
Does someone say flap? I can do this. Does that make me a wing? Yeah? They are modified. They do flap indeed, but they are modified for flight. That's a very simple way of saying it though. What happens to them really is that they are modified so that feathers can attach to them in many ways. So you've got, I think there's a better diagram. Let me go to the bigger diagram. So when we've got our own arms, we've got the humerus, we've got radius and ulna, and we've got carpals and phalanges, right? Yeah? You've got a humerus here, a radius and an ulna in a bird too, but you've got something called a carpometacarpus. Why? Because of bone fusion. And then you've got these phalanges that stick out here, and all of these have feathers and muscles attached to them that make the wing more aerodynamic and also enable them to be flapped and also to resist the stresses associated with flapping. Because you actually go through a lot of wear and tear if you keep flapping your wings. So these bones thicken up in a lot of birds that fly with a lot of power, so that they can resist the stresses associated with flight. Now, if you were a bird that flew different ways, many different ways, I think Ashwin talked a little bit about it, right? You've got gliders and birds that flap their wings a lot. So something that flaps its wing a lot, like a pigeon, would need short and relatively thick bones here, right? And it would need to be supported closer to the base, so it has more power to do that. An albatross glides for the most part. So the bones in question become really long and slender, relatively not that thin, but quite thin, in order to support an extremely elongated wing that then just has to glide, because the wear and tear in this case doesn't come from repeated flapping. So it can essentially be long and slender and still support an albatross's gliding flight even for thousands of kilometers. So you can, by looking at the ratios of the length of these bones, tell what kind of flight a bird might have. And you can look backwards and see where they originated from by looking at mammalian limbs, right? See our carpals and metacarpals here and how they've all fused in the bird. Look at all of our separate phalanges, fingers, and see how they've all fused into this little nub in birds. So bone fusion is widespread across the bird skeleton, mostly driven by the need to attach really powerful muscles for flight. Make sense to everyone? And when you go flightless, like a kiwi, that's all the wing bone you have left. Okay? There's a word for that, right? V starts with V?
Vestigial.
So they're vestigial wings because I'm sure everybody knows kiwis can't fly. Yeah? Okay, so this is just talking about stuff I've already talked about. Also, kiwis lay giant eggs, just so you know. So they have a pelvic girdle that is extremely wide so that an egg that large can actually be laid. That is an egg inside a kiwi, and it looks positively traumatic. The bird foot too has bone fusion. Okay, instead of a carpo metacarpus, you've got a tarso metatarsus. Okay, it's all the same thing. Names notwithstanding, there are a bunch of bones that fuse together. Okay, so you've got fusion in the arms, you've got fusion in the legs, and all of those are driven to accommodate the posture of bird legs for their own cursorial type of locomotion. Okay? What trade-off do you think drives the leg bones? Speed. If you want to run really fast, your legs have to be?
Strong.
Strong, but also?
Long.
And? Light, yes. Strong and light, okay? Because you can't really run fast if you have very heavy legs. All right, try attaching weights to your own legs and try to run, you will fall flat on your face very quickly. Okay, so the trade-off between being strong and being light has driven a lot of our understanding of how bird bones work. Bird bones, and of course, there's a whole bunch of things that happen to birds' feet. I'm not going to go into that in great detail, but depending on what they're using their feet for, to hang from things, to perch on things, their toes are oriented in various different directions. You know, they're, you know, whatever, anisodactyl, tridactyl, didactyl, they're all from some names for toes point in different directions. Okay? So I won't go into that in too much detail. And like I said, here's where we get the muscles. Let's go into a little more soft tissue now. When all the bones are said and done and fused, why are they fused, we said? Because they want to provide attachment points for larger muscles. And this is the pectoralis, the muscle that drives the wing of a budgerigar. Look how big it is. What are these muscles? Attaching to the fused leg bones, right? They give the bird's leg strength when it's perching. Look how big they are. By contrast, look how small and thin muscles around the neck and other places are, because they don't need as much power as these giant flight muscles. Our own pectoral and thoracic muscles are much smaller relative to our size than those of a bird, because these muscles generate tremendous power. And in order to generate tremendous power, what do they need?
Energy.
Where are they getting it from? So birds eat a lot?
Yes.
Yes, they do. Is there something else muscles need to function?
Oxygen.
Yeah, so let's zip on down to the respiratory system and see how their muscles get enough oxygen. Okay, where do we get oxygen from for our own muscular activities? Breathe in, breathe out, get rid of all that useless carbon dioxide, take in some oxygen. Birds need a lot more oxygen per unit weight than we do, just because of the demands of flight. And how they get that is they have a very non-standard lung. You see the shriveled little thing out here? That is the bird lung. But this is the rest of the bird respiratory system. They are not lungs, they are air sacs. Okay? So when air goes into the lungs, it gets shunted into one air sac, then into another, and then into another in some very complicated way, and then finally out. So each breath of air that's taken in is not let out at the next cycle. It's actually let out much later. And by traveling through these air sacs, they get as much oxygen out of the air as possible, because the entire surface area of your respiratory system increases massively. And the more surface area you have, the more oxygen you're going to absorb. That said, there's another advantage to having all these air sacs in there. What do you think that is? Yeah, makes them a little more lighter as well. So birds have a little clever solution, which is they make themselves lighter and they get more air out of their system for every breath they take. Yeah? So that's the cool way a bird's respiratory system works. It serves multiple purposes, ultimately all saying, I need power, but I need to be light. Okay? I know I'm repeating this a lot, but some things bear repeating, and I think if you bear that central idea in mind, you'll be able to solve most problems related to how birds work. Okay? Here's that complex way in which air gets shunted into air sacs and then out of the bird's respiratory system. Like someone said birds need more food, right? Birds have to eat this food in order to get it, and their digestive systems broadly work the same way as ours do, but with two big differences I'd like you to note. One is the crop, and one is this little pouch here called a gizzard. Okay? Some people are nodding, so who knows what a crop is?
It's a sack of sorts used for storing food.
It's a storage area, okay? Think of it as a little larder to keep food when you're not sure whether you're going to get food again anytime soon. Okay, what is a gizzard? Yeah, a gizzard is the bird's kitchen table. It's where all the processing of food happens before it goes further down into the gut. That's not to say some processing can't happen in the crop. This is a bird called a huatzin. Okay? A huatzin actually eats plant material and to a large degree ferments it in its crop with the help of bacteria. So it ferments it so that it's much easier to process once it goes further down. Pigeons have crops, right? They have a crop that is useful to store food when they take it back to their young. So typically this slightly mashed up food is taken there and then they regurgitate food from the crop for their young, which is why any bird feeding its young involves this, you know, this very, except for some birds. Some birds don't do that, but pigeons definitely do it. Yeah. Storks in some cases, or pelicans will stick their head, the young will stick their head right into the adult's beak, and that's where they get their food from. The gizzard usually has stones and grit that help grind food up and process it so that the digestive system can handle it. In that case, I love this photo. It's a little gruesome, But you can see this is a, what is it? This is a dove. Of course, it's a pigeon. That has some fruit that it's eaten here, and these little yellow bits are stones and grit that are part of the gizzard to help it digest things. So you'll often see pigeons flying down. Yeah, so those of you who like the bird, you often see pigeons by tracks in the morning, like by jeep tracks or paved tracks. And what they're often doing there early in the morning is eating a little grit to help them get through the day's food. So you'll see some of them pecking at stuff, and sometimes they're actually pecking at food, but sometimes they're also swallowing tiny stones that go and sit in the gizzard. So that's pretty cool. And those are the two basic ways in which birds' digestive systems differ from our own. All right? Some birds, like I said, don't really have very functional grinding implements, and they eat things like bones and stuff that aren't, that'll clog up their digestive tract really quick. So if you're an owl or a falcon or something else like that, you just get what you can out of your food and just puke out the rest. Okay, that's what owl pellets are. And we had a couple of really nice talks over the symposium about people going through owl pellets to find out what they ate. So if you want to analyze an owl's diet, you don't have to dissect the owl, just go and find this pellet, take it apart, use the anatomical knowledge you get from the skeleton, and you can figure out what the owl ate. Which is pretty cool, I thought. Yeah? What goes in must eventually come out. Correct? So in a bird's case, it comes out of the cloaca, which they've retained from their reptilian ancestors. It's an all-purpose opening through which everything that comes in goes out, more or less, except pellets. All right? Won't go into too much detail about that. I think I've only got a few minutes left. Let's jump over to some physiology, shall we? Okay? So the other aspects of bird systems, I'm not going to go into too much detail on. Actually, I think I can shut this here, if you guys don't mind. And we'll just have a little chat about how birds might regulate themselves according to their environment, okay? There's a few important environmental parameters that you all pay attention to, right? Any of you who want to go out in the field, okay, we'll have to take concern of a couple of things. What are you going to have to take concern of? If it's cold, you're going to have to dress for the cold, right? If it's wet, you're going to have to dress for the wet, but as Ashwin told you, some birds have ways of doing that. The other thing you need to worry about is taking plenty of water, right? So if you want to understand the basics of bird physiology, you pay attention to two major things, temperature and water, and you'll understand how birds are capable of most of the feats that they are. So birds can survive at a whole range of temperatures, right? Who knows a bird that survives in very cold conditions?
Penguins.
Penguins. Who knows a bird that survives in very hot conditions?
Ostrich.
Ostrich?
Owls.
Owls. Anyone know birds that survive in hotter conditions than that? Huh? Roadrunners.
Sandgrouse.
Yeah, sandgrouse are some of the most heat-tolerant birds on the planet. Okay, there are some larks, like who knows what the greater hoopoe lark is? Yeah, there's a bird called the greater hoopoe lark that in Africa and the Sahara can tolerate sand temperatures of up to 70 degrees. Okay, and it nests in temperatures like that too, which is ridiculous. So they do this by keeping track of the temperature and keeping track of water. Those are the two things that they need to keep attention, pay attention to the most, or they will die. Okay, some birds, when it gets really cold, will lose heat faster than others. What is that based on? Body size. Okay, so they have many options. What do? You can replace it by generating heat really quickly. But what does that mean? You have to keep eating like crazy. Okay, hummingbirds have to do that because they dissipate heat and lose heat so fast that unless they keep feeding every few hours, they will die. All right, some birds don't have that option. Then what do?
Hibernation?
Well, they don't go into hibernation, they go into what's called torpor for short periods. Some birds do pseudo versions of it, but there's a bird in North America called the kinglet. Okay? It's called the golden crown kinglet if you're interested. That is tiny and does not hibernate. Survives at up to minus 40 or minus 50 degrees. What do you think it does? That's right.
Does it lower its metabolic rate?
It does lower its metabolic rate to a certain degree. It also goes out only during the warmest times of the day. It spends the rest of the day in tree hollows where there's a little more heat, so the temperature is higher. And then they do a bunch of things. When it's cold, they withdraw their extremities inside so that they don't lose heat. When you're out in the cold, you'll realize you lose heat through your fingers, etc., etc. They don't do that. They withdraw their extremities and they go and sit in huddles. Everyone's seen emperor penguins huddling, right? Huddling is a way to conserve and minimize heat loss because when you're a big group, you have less exposed surface area relative to your size. Okay? Small birds have more exposed surface area and lose heat like crazy. What do you do if there's too much heat?
Open your mouth.
By that logic, I should be dealing with excess heat very well right now. What do dogs do in excess heat? Yeah, anyone seen a bird pant?
Yes,
open beaks. Open beaks, yeah. And have you seen their throats go? It's called gular flutter. Yeah? Birds do that to dissipate excess heat. You don't withdraw your extremities, okay? You try to wet yourself a little bit because that will help you lose excess heat. So birds go and dunk themselves in water a little bit sometimes. Vultures do something particularly gross. They urinate down their legs and that helps them dissipate some excess heat. Or you can raise your body temperature slightly and adjust your metabolism so that you accept this extra heat and don't overcompensate. Okay? Sand grouse do that. Larks do it. Okay? Camels are very, very good at it. They basically give themselves a fever so that they can deal with the excesses of temperature. And birds do this all to maintain their body temperature at a level of between 39 and 43 degrees. They're slightly higher than our own temperature, but they're extremely good at maintaining them. They're also extremely good at sensing them. I think at some point someone will talk about nesting, but there's a bird I teach about in one of my classes called the mallee fowl, which has a thermometer in its beak. And it uses that to remove and adjust the levels of sand over its eggs to maintain them at a constant temperature. Okay? The other thing you need to pay attention to is water. Gular flutter is all very well and good for a minor, but if a minor were in a desert, there's a problem with it. If you keep panting, you're going to lose water like crazy with each of those pants, right? So what are you going to do? Are you going to just keep drinking water? How do you deal with water loss?
Absorb water from face.
Huh?
Absorb water from face.
Try to get all the water you can out of your food, sure. Or drink water like crazy whenever you find it, sure. Yeah?
Sir, controlling the excretion.
Hmm? Yeah, so you control your, how do you control your excretion?
In more concentrated.
You concentrate it?
Yeah.
Yes, so birds excrete uric acid, which is a water conservation technique, right? And that allows them to void potentially harmful nitrogenous waste before it accumulates without actually losing a lot of water when they do. So they have ways around the water balance problem as well, right? The other thing you do is just don't go out when it's really hot, right? You rest under shade. Have any of you live in particularly hot regions that have redwattle lapwings, for instance? The redwattle lapwings on the IISER Pune campus go to under trees. They stand under all the trees when it's really hot. And they don't come out. They stand under lampposts that have these little dome tops. And they don't come out. And they'll let you get pretty close to them because they are not moving out into that weather. Yeah? Also don't go out when it's really cold. So your foraging patterns can be adjusted to compensate for extremes in temperature and extremes of water. Alright? So that's really cool. And I'll end, do I have a few more minutes, Sahil?
Yeah,
okay. I'll end with another aspect of physiology that's important to consider when you go to birds, and that is sensory physiology. Alright? The sensory physiology of birds is another key aspect to understanding why they do what they do. Right? Much like us, birds can see, birds can hear. Right? They produce sounds as well. They produce sounds with a structure called the syrinx. Okay, they don't use the larynx up here like we do. The syrinx is down near the bronchi. And when air is moved across it, it sets it into vibration. And these vibrations, much like I'm doing now, are sound that travels across and can be heard by you. Correct? This is how birds communicate with each other too. But they also have very interesting features of their eyes. And there's, of course, smell, which I'll talk about briefly if I have a few minutes. There's an important difference between bird eyes and ours. Who can tell me what that is? Huh? That's not the only one, but what is it you said? That's right. Oh, someone was at my talk yesterday, huh? Yeah. Birds are tetrachromats. We have three color receptors, birds have four. Okay? Many birds can see ultraviolet. But even birds that can't have a violet, blue, green, and red color receptor. And that means the available color space that they can perceive is huge. It's an order of magnitude higher than our own. So the way a bird sees the world in color is very, very different from the way we see it. And because of that, bird colors exploit many different regions of the color spectrum, some of which are not available, visible even to us. All right? Because of that, birds can potentially detect ultraviolet patterns in the sky, and although there's no clear evidence of this yet, some people believe they can actually use that to navigate in ways that we ourselves cannot. And these are problems of sensory physiology. Okay? Birds have evolved extremely sensitive eyes in the dark by doing what? If you want to see in the dark, what do? Make your eyes bigger. Yeah? Or you increase the sensitivity of your eyes by adding more light-sensitive receptors to them so you can see even under very dimly lit conditions. Alright? The ears of birds have undergone very similar modifications. The barn owl is one of my favorite examples of that. The barn owl has ears that are asymmetric in its head. And using the timing and intensity differences between these, it can pinpoint the location of even very faint sounds in three dimensions. So if there was a rat rustling at nearly the other end of this room, a barn owl would be able to pinpoint its exact location and go and find it in pitch dark, using only its ear. People have done experiments on this to show that the barn owl's ears are extremely sensitive to directional sound. And so are many birds. Try that experiment if you see a bird go and it looks straight at you, especially an owl. Very, very sensitive, very accurate. All right, an owl will hear your footsteps from sometimes 100 feet away and it'll turn and look directly at you. A lot of people say owls know they're being watched. It's not that they know they're being watched, they have very, very sensitive ears. So they can hear even the faintest of sounds. And although birds' brains have largely very small olfactory lobes, the last thing I'm going to leave you with is that some birds can use smell in very unique ways as well. Okay, the procellariforms that I showed you earlier, there's a group called tube noses. Yes, petrels in particular. They have long tubular nostrils along their beak, the nares, all right? You see these little openings in the bill, that's where the bird's nostrils are. These guys have elongated nostrils that are very sensitive to odors, and from kilometers away, they can track fish odors, and they track these odors much the same way an insect or a dog or anything does, and come straight to it. So people out doing research on seabirds, one of the easiest ways to get them to come to you, so you know what seabirds are in area, is to dump fish oil over the side of the boat. That's what they call charm, yes. And seabirds will come to these from kilometers away because they can pick them up with their nose. And there are people who've done experiments to show that it is in fact their noses that they're using. And they can detect these odors from kilometers away. They put a little GPS backpack on them and let them loose. And from the GPS data, you can see the bird encounter the odor, turn, and start to go cast around back and forth until it finds out where the odor is coming from and then start moving in that direction. And if it loses the trail, it casts about again and moves in that direction until it eventually arrives at the boat. Okay? So with that, I'll move on to the next module and end here. And I hope I've been able to give you guys a flavor for all of the complex things that birds are able to do and all the different ways in which birds look and their anatomy. And if there's any questions, I will take them now. Thank you. Thank you.